Your Honour, these are the facts of the case. 64 million years ago, these here dinosaurs disappeared, leaving a trail of bones, fossils and footprints scattered all over the world. No murder weapon has been found. No witnesses have come forward. In fact, nobody knows note about who killed them at all. But we all have our favourite lines of inquiry.
Meat eaters like Tyrannosaurus Rex kept eating them and They became extinct, so Tyrannosaurus Rex didn't have any food to eat.
Change of climate could have made the food go, and so the herbivores couldn't eat no plants, and the carnivores couldn't eat any of the animals because they're dead.
A great big meteorite struck Earth, struck the Moon because it was on a collision course for Earth, blotting out the Earth for a certain matter of days, and the confusion in the bodies of the dinosaurs run by the Moon, as the Moon controls many of our actions. They probably went around killing each other or died from certain diseases which were like chickenpox. And they went around just dying all over the place.
That's the only thing we can be sure about. But let's have a look at some of the wilder theories, the ones that would never stand up in court. Sorry, Noah's Ark is full up. Catch the next boat. Why did the dinosaurs miss that boat? I reckon because they went to the wrong travel agency. Did little green hunters from outer space want to add dinosaurs to their wildlife collection? That would have made a splash on the interplanetary news, and who knows, one day they might set them free again. The plant life changed, and that meant the dinosaurs' diet changed too. They couldn't buy laxatives anywhere. And prunes, they hadn't been invented yet. Did they grow so huge that their backs gave way under the strain? Boy, dem bones, dem poor old bones. Did things get too hot for the boys and only the girls were left? Bad luck, ladies. It's enough to make the dinosaurs turn in their graves. Of all the weird and wonderful scientific and sensible suggestions, what did kill them off? Did the climate become too hot or too cold, too wet or too dry? Did small mammals eat all the dinosaur eggs, or were they poisoned by new types of plants? Eventually, were there too many carnivorous dinosaurs that ate the plant eaters and then died of starvation? Or was it a culmination of many causes over a long period of time, or a sudden explosion that wiped them all out? They just all went up in smoke. Dozens of theories have been put forward, and some are immediately dismissed by the dinosaur experts, but others command more attention. Michael Allaby, co-author of a new book called The Great Extinction, believes the answer came from outer space. So how does he think they were all killed off?
In rocks that were formed up to 65 million years ago, there are fossils of them. Then there's a boundary layer of clay, just a few centimetres thick, above that new rock, with fossils of quite different animals. The dinosaurs had gone. The boundary layer contains relatively huge amounts of some very rare metals like iridium and osmium. The only way you can explain them getting there is by allowing a meteorite to collide with the Earth coming from space and deposit itself all over the Earth. It was 6 or more miles across. It was traveling very fast at about 45,000 miles an hour, 60 times the speed of sound, get you from here to New York in about 4 minutes, and released a really colossal amount of energy.
Whereabouts on Earth did it hit?
Probably somewhere in the North Atlantic, somewhere near where Iceland is now.
Did these dinosaurs all die out in one day or over a period of time?
We think it was probably less than 200 years. That's a very short time.
Yeah, well, what evidence do you have for this?
Well, we think that there was a a huge heat surge. I mean, this object came in with all this energy. Most of it was released as heat. So there'd be a huge heat surge, and these large animals have much more difficulty coping with heat than they do with cold, or than small animals do coping with heat. At the same time, there'd be a huge amount of dust in the air, which would also alter the climate temporarily. Probably plants were coated with dust, and the thing itself was poisonous.
Yeah, so you've got a sort of greenhouse effect.
You've got a kind of greenhouse effect, which would probably knock out a large number of the animals, and those that survived would be breeding very much less, probably because they were so dispersed.
Yeah, but there were quite a few that survived, though,
weren't there? There were a lot of animals that survived, and they survived, it seems, for one of two reasons. Either they were in water, like crocodiles and turtles, or they were small. Small animals, as I say, didn't have this problem, and most of the small animals who survived were mammals.
Yeah, well, what about the vegetation? Because
the vegetation seems to have been affected. It seems to have died down, but vegetation isn't affected over a long time in the same way because it has seed, and a lot of seed would be lying on the ground in the soil, and that would germinate when things got better, and the vegetation would recover.
Yeah. Now, this crater that happened sort of around Iceland would have been massive.
Yeah, it would probably have been something like 200 miles across.
Is there any evidence of it left?
No, to be honest. But that's probably because it went into the sea. If it had gone onto land, then we might very well have a crater to show for it.
So it ends up in the sea, and what happens?
It ends up in the sea. Water surges back in immediately, and that starts disturbing the whole surface, and the seabed itself moves the whole time.
Well, would it have gone through the mantle?
It probably would, yes. Yeah. And it would have exposed magma beneath, and this would have just have added to the explosion.
It must have been a horrendous day.
It was the worst news they'd had all week.
Beverley, you've heard of the Great Extinction by Mike Allaby and Jim Lovelock. What do you think of that theory?
Well, not really very much. Mm. It's the most exciting theory that's been around for years. I mean, the idea of a meteorite just zapping the Earth is really exciting and thrilling. There's just one or two odd things that aren't really quite OK. I mean, for example, the last dinosaurs died out 700,000 years after this supposed event. Mm. Well, it's very difficult to think of, you know, dinosaurs saying, well, this is going to zap us, and then they hang around for 700,000 years. I mean, it just isn't on. And this, the key thing is this iridium level, this clay with this high iridium, which they said must have come from out of space. Mm. Well, 240 metres below that level, there's twice as much iridium concentration. And they've all now been connected up with volcanic eruptions and the sort of what's going on at the bottom of the sea.
Yeah.
So there's no need to have something coming from outer space. And the timing of all the different extinctions just won't fit. It's a lovely theory, we'd love to have it, but sorry, mate, no can do.
You must have your own theory.
Well, the trouble with the theories that we, well, people like I have, is that they're boring. They're not exciting. You've got to collect all the evidence from wherever you are and then see what it comes out like, and it tends to be boring. Mm. But one thing that Mike Allaby did say, which is very, very critical, and he emphasised the point very well, and that is the sudden increase of heat and this greenhouse effect. Now, I think the idea that his explanation of it was a bit cockeyed, but nevertheless we do have evidence of a sudden temperature increase, and this seems to be related to movement of continents and affecting the microscopic animals in the sea and the large ones on the land, because heat is the problem. And so we have this rather slow climatic changes. The dinosaurs have been dying out over several million years. You had major changes in plant life and with the small mammals. And so it's a combination of all these things together. In fact, all the evidence you can find, you bung in.
Yep.
And you have, you know, what is not exciting, but we think is getting closer to the truth.
So it could remain a mystery for a long, long time, could the extinction of the dinosaur?
I think it's got to remain a mystery, because otherwise, if we know all the answers, we're out of a job.
Dinosaurs are celebrities, but they do have problems with their public image, and some people want to wipe them off the map completely. The Mobil Oil Company, for example, branded the dinosaurs as energy wasters. Auto Guzzlosaurus Rex, for instance, guzzles petrol like there's no tomorrow. Or Heatlosaurus Domesticus, who hasn't a clue how to insulate his lair. A Macorbidactyl, who turns a blind eye to the energy crisis, but thinks something's always bound to turn up in the end. If I was a dinosaur, I'd sue! Actually, that nearly happened a few years ago when an advert claimed that Audi cars beat the luckless Brontosaur hands down for efficiency. And that certainly set the old bones rattling in museums up and down the country. In fact, our own Alan Charig accused Audi of libel. Examined plenty of fossils, footprints and bones along the dinosaur trail, and by now I thought I'd seen everything, but not quite. Hidden deep in the depths of the Natural History Museum behind locked doors is one of the most beautiful, rare and valuable fossils in the world, and it's also a vital clue, not only to the past, but also to the present and future of all dinosaurs. I asked Dr. Alan Charig if he'd dig out the key and give his priceless treasure an airing.
Each sort of animal has its ancestors. Mm. And we know that the ancestors of the birds were the reptiles. Now, many people think that the particular reptiles that the birds came from were the dinosaurs. And particularly interesting in that connection is this fossil, because this is a beautiful sort of halfway house, halfway between reptiles, which were evolving into birds. This animal comes from Germany.
Yeah.
It's about 150 million years old. And its name is Archaeopteryx, which means ancient wing. This is the most famous fossil in the whole world. I should think if we put it on the open market in the States, say, between the big museums, auctioned it, you'd get several million dollars. A lot of things about it are still very much reptilian. In fact, if it were not for two things, we would think it was the skeleton of a small running dinosaur. Yeah. And the two things which give the game away are this boomerang shaped object, which is the wishbone, and the feathers. You see, there are impressions of feathers in the rock all around its tail and up here on its, call them wings if you like.
Now, have these feathers actually developed from millions of years ago to today, the birds' feathers? Are they any different?
They're almost exactly the same. If you take a microscope and look at these, you'll find that in their structure and in the way they're placed on the front legs around the tail, they're exactly like the feathers of a modern bird.
And it's got these bird-like claws as well.
Yes, the claw does look rather as though it were meant for perching, doesn't it, with this opposite toe to all the other toes. But in most other respects, it's still very much a reptile. The front legs aren't, the bones aren't changed at all in the way, say, the wing of a chicken is. They're still very much like the front leg of a dinosaur, and it even has claws on its hand.
Oh, yes, yeah.
And it's got this long, bony tail. Modern birds don't have long tails, they only have feathers. And it also has, and this is very important, unlike modern birds, it has teeth.
Oh.
No modern birds have teeth at all. But this animal has still got proper teeth like a reptile.
So humans and dinosaurs, or rather their descendants, now live side by side after all. I think I might have a little more respect for the sparrow in the garden in the future. But there is a postscript to add to the case of the disappearing dinosaur. Because when they became extinct, some creatures survived. The crocodile, the snake, the lizard and the turtle, and one very important group of animals, the mammal. Alan Charig completes the story.
The mammals started at about the same time, or just after the dinosaurs started.
And what were these mammals like?
Well, they were very different from the mammals you think of that are living today. They were nearly all very small, and even the largest was no bigger than a cat. In fact, the very first ones were about the size of a shrew, just 2 or 3 inches long. I don't think the dinosaurs would even have noticed the mammals, but they weren't worth eating, they were that small.
Yeah.
And as for their mode of life, the mammals were largely nocturnal. They hid in burrows during the day, they came out at night, they lived mainly upon insects. And incidentally, because they lived at night, that was why they have such a well-developed sense of smell.
Now, what happened to these mammals once the dinosaurs had become extinct?
Well, the mammals were not the cause of the dinosaurs' extinction. We must get that clear.
Yeah.
There were other reasons why the dinosaurs died out. But once the dinosaurs were gone, then there was a whole wide world ready for the mammals to exploit. And immediately, they started getting bigger, they started doing all sorts of things. Some went back into the sea and became whales, others went into the air and became bats. They did all sorts of things, and some of them, as you know, became very large indeed.
And turned into us, in fact. We're part of that system.
Eventually, they produced man. Yes.
What if these dinosaurs had never become extinct? Where would we be?
I don't suppose we'd be here today at all, because, after all, the mammals would have had to remain small and inconspicuous, waiting in the wings, as it were, while the dinosaurs still occupied the centre of the stage. People always use the word dinosaur thinking of something that is slow and stupid and clumsy and that's why it died out. Well, that, of course, is a load of rubbish. Because, after all, any animal, if it's going to survive, has got to be adapted to the environment it lives in. And the dinosaurs, in fact, were very well adapted to the many environments they lived in. Some of them were very fast-running, very active animals indeed. And after all, the dinosaurs as a group lived for 140 million years. Now, man has lived for 4 million years. Do you honestly believe that we're going to do as well as they did?
Million years down, 136 million to go, and boy, that's some record to beat. The dinosaur trail sadly comes to a halt here, but it'll never really end. New discoveries are made every year. An entire continent, Antarctica, has yet to be explored for dinosaur remains, and who knows what new evidence will melt out of the ice, bringing forth fresh clues into the lives and deaths of dinosaurs. And sometime in the distant future, perhaps by some strange quirk of evolution, the dinosaur will return. And when the dinosaur comes back, I want to be there! Well, don't you? Good. We'll meet again then. Bye. Hey-ho, Brontosaur!